television series wherein I make a well-argued case for them to base the character or storyline on you in the new series. But as you know from letters I have already written to you previously, I am much better at meta letters. And I also so desperately want to actually talk to you right now, and you feel so far away since no one knows where you actually are. So instead, I'm going to read a letter about that letter to a life-size representation of you in front of a group of people wearing a Star Trek uniform, because that seems to me the closest I can get to actually speaking to you in the type of world that I want to live in. So in my dream world, where this hypothetical letter is not only written, but also read by people with decision-making power, it would be a success and eventually lead to you being released from your imprisonment, which, as you know, has been declared arbitrary by the United Nations. Because by entering into the popular semi-global consciousness through the route of the new Star Trek series, your story would be shaped in such a way that it could finally prove strategic enough for your release to be touted as a tremendous show of good faith by the government of Bashar al-Assad and a significant step forward in the peace process in Syria. So I was stuck on what my elevator pitch would be for the argument to convince the producers. I kept thinking about what your uncle wrote in the Cost of Freedom book about how you taught yourself English from a CD that your father gave you when you were only 12, and that you had an incredibly sophisticated technical vocabulary, especially when discussing computers. The programming of which you also taught yourself, at least after a half-hour lesson with another uncle, whose teacher you became after only a few years of self-instruction. And there is also the story of the Google Lunar X Prize. I only know about this year's tweet, circa 2010, but it sounded like you were leading a team to work together at IT Lab, trying to build a prototype of a rocket that could go to the moon and send back loads to Earth, all using open source tools. Imagine how different our world would be if you had not been arrested and had been able to continue that work, and you were successful in your efforts, working from inside the first hackerspace in Syria to demonstrate that open source tools and the values of the free culture community can take us literally to new worlds. Instead, after the outbreak of violence in Syria, you converted Niki Lab into a triage center, a place where first aid classes were offered and basic first aid was provided. You did this because getting access to medical care, even basic procedures, had become not only difficult but dangerous, and as bombing hospitals and medical clinics became, and still is, a strategy of government forces. And all the while, you're still an active volunteer in major open source projects, including Mozilla, Creative Commons, and Wikipedia, helping to improve the utility in the Arabic language in Arabic-speaking countries. And in both the reality of what happened, where you were arrested on the one-year anniversary of the Syrian uprising, and were missing in October of this year, and in the parallel imaginary world in which you helped bring Syria and the open source community into the space industry and created in world-changing ways, both of these seem like scenarios that fit perfectly into the as-yet unwritten backstory of the Star Trek universe. Both its real world and the mirror universe. After all, Zephyr Cochrane's development of faster-than-light travel is less than 50 years away from us now. And it would be fitting for the path toward this discovery to have been started in Damascus, the longest continually inhabited city on Earth. And especially now that the relationship between television and the internet arguably makes new forms of storytelling possible, because on-demand services forge a new method of payment which eliminates the need for commercials, and thereby gives storytellers more space to address complex moral and philosophical questions, like how to end the war in Syria without starting another one. And this space where television programs are allowed to actually make you think was the space which the original Star Trek series was one of the first to probe. And I think that is it, Bassel. That is the kernel I need to focus on in this letter. The manner in which technological innovation and literacy, and those who help to spread it, are seen paradoxically as threats to the existing power structures, and also as key ingredients to national defense and economic power and autonomy. Because your story gets at that, in a manner that is as devastating as it is romantic. So there was once a personal and existential value in it as a tool for contemplating the nature of human knowledge and thought. In her words, it's as though the world of the Enterprise were an image which recalls to mind our intuitive knowledge of some Platonic reality. Gene Roddenberry's response contains a poignant note to end on, especially considering the manner in which television production has changed since the mid-1960s. Incidentally, I also agree with your comment that Star Trek was not really great literature or great drama. It seems to me, however, it might merit some consideration as art, since art must be judged in the context of its medium. A man who produces temporary things with colored sand on a London sidewalk is not necessarily less an artist than one who creates in finer detail and perspective through the advantages of oils and canvas. Considering the limitations imposed by television timing budget, the equivalent